destinations. I've not been doing any topic of him. I was asked to elaborate it, but I had to leave the country for a few days, and I came day before midnight. So I'm still having what is called a deadline. I hope by looking at my face you will understand it. I'm recovering. What I want to talk to you this morning, very briefly, is theory, method, and empirical reality in social science. It's a very broad area. And I've looked at the kind of topics covered, quite a few important and interesting areas have been covered. These social scientists claim scientificity. Sociologists have done, but I happen to be a sociologist. It's called the social physics in the beginning. So, the aspiration was all social sciences to become close to exact sciences, like physics, chemistry, geology, or whatever it is. So, the initial stage was to understand whether there can be a sociology, a social science, which is of universal kind, universality. There has been debates, I will not go into it. And sciences are supposed to produce what is called laws, generalizing laws. Normothetic is a word. I hope you are familiar with the phraseology. If you don't, tell me, I will write it on the blackboard here. Oh, it's a whiteboard, sorry. So, the normothetic orientation is said to be the crux of the scientific field. But in the social sciences, there has been debates that we cannot produce laws which are of universal or global application. Therefore, we must think in terms of ideographic orientation. Ideographic means that which deals with the specificity of a system. History, for example, is usually taken to be ideographic in its orientation. We talk about, not universal history, but Indian history, or Pakistan history, so many people wanted to create what is called a social science, a sociology, or media studies, which is specific to particular countries and societies. And that was referred to as indigeneity. Is Indian sociology Indian? Or Indian media studies Indian or something else? So indigenous versus the universality question has been debated. But broadly speaking, I would say there are three methodological orientations in social sciences or in sciences. One is positivism. Positivism is that tendency or that approach which believes that all branches of knowledge can be studied through one methodological approach. But the subject matter may be different. Prof. Das will say that I have not grown beyond my classical theorist. A man called Bukhar said, sociology deals with social facts, economics deals with something else. But all these sciences, not only sociology, physics, whatever, can be studied through a methodology through the focus positivism. So the positivistic understanding is that you can study all branches of knowledge through one simple uniform methodology. After some time, and the name we are all very familiar with, man called Marx, says similarly that whatever may be your subject matter, basket making, butchery, philosophy, you can study through dialectical materialism. That's a methodological orientation. Again, I will not elaborate, because my purpose is different. But then came a third person, Max Weber, who said, what is important in order to understand a field is to introduce method which is peculiar or which will necessarily capture the reality of that field. And he referred to, later interpreted said that this should be called humanism. Humanism is not an ideological position. It is, but in this context, it only means that we are dealing with humans. And humans are quite different from the rest of the entities, creatures in the universe. And therefore, we need to have a different understanding, different methodology. He said, you must have method worst time, which means take the position of the other, get into the shoes of the other. Suppose we want to study the Adivasis of this country. And the only Adivasi person in this group, you see, is 8% of the population, which means 18 million, but not a single person who is here. These are indications of how things are going, but anyway. So, we must have empathy with the subject that we study. It could be a Dalit, it could be women, it could be Adivasi, but we must take the position of them in order to understand their position. So they are teach. Now, we have never come across, I believe, a physicist talking about German physics or Indian physics or American physics. But we all talk about social sciences, which are specific to our area, our areas. So, the first thing we must understand, if we accept the proposition, and I do, that we use methods which are specific, methodologies which are specific to the subject matter that we are studying. I divide or categorize the fields of knowledge, I'm not talking of disciplines here, the fields of knowledge into three. First, those fields which I would call deal with material sciences, material things, wood, rock, and whatnot. So, we can think in terms of studying material things. And so many people study, some of you might have studied physics or chemistry, geology, or whatever. We are studying material things. What is the importance or what is the specificity of material things? It is one dimensional. You are studying matter. And this matter that we have in mind, they also interact. And this interaction creates some results. So, the objects in the material world are capable of reactivity. All of you have studied that before, isn't it? You are teaching like a frog putting sodium in water and something happens. Or, what is it, magnet and iron, they jump. Or you might have come across, of course, huge things like earthquakes, tsunami. Only the other day there was a very substantial disturbance in certain parts of this country, like the Okinawa disturbances from the sea. So, when you study as a physicist, as a geologist, you are studying matter as it is one-dimensional. The matter involved, the elements involved in that field has no agency. And we are capable of reactivity. Let me shift to the world of life sciences. A rock doesn't have life. Wood doesn't have life. But as we have life, So if we shift from the world of material sciences, the objects in that world, material world, are only capable of reactivity, to the world of life sciences, there are two kinds of things in the world of life. One is plants, the other is animals. We are both plants and animals in the world of life sciences. Now, if the objects in the material world are only capable of reactivity, the objects in the world of life sciences is capable of responsivity. There are scientists who have told us, yes, it was, for example, you have heard of it, that if music is played, when a cow is milked, it will yield more milk. Have you heard about this? If music is played in a given direction, the plants which are growing will respond to that, the creeper. So, both plants and animals, which are the objects of study in the world of life sciences, are capable of responding, responsibility, which is different from reactivity. Because the elements in the world of material world are not capable of response, but they are only capable of reaction. So, these elements or objects of study in the world of life sciences is capable of responsibility. Now, there is a difference, however, between plants on the one hand and animals on the other. Plants are not capable of behavior. Animals are capable of behavior. You know, it's a little more difficult terrain. Suppose you cut a plant right out. It will not be in a position to do any harm to you. But suppose you beat your pet dog, it might bite you. So animals are capable of behavior, plants, generally speaking, are not capable of behavior. So that complicates the study. A botanist who is studying only plants, animals, sorry, plants and trees, and a zoologist who is studying animals. Although both of them are called biologists, generally speaking, the objects they study are different because the animals are capable of, as I said, responding to you. There was a social psychologist, Musafir Sharif, if I remember correctly, I studied him for my MA. He said, human beings as well as animals have motives. But animals have what is called biogenic motives. The motives of animals are rooted in biology. But human beings have sociogenic motives. That is, motives which are rooted in his or her culture. So, researchers in the world of life sciences, I would say this, is more complex than studying the material sciences, those which deal with matter. Now, so far, we have no problem, so we couldn't deal with them. We come to the third segment. So, the field which deals with only matter, the field which deals with matter and life, and the third is the field which deals with matter. As biological human beings, we are all bundles of cells. Life, we have some life, and the most significant part of our sciences or social sciences that we study, culture. Only human beings have culture. If we need that culture, life would have been much easier. Because we have culture, life is much more complex. So, if material sciences can only have reactivity, life sciences can have a responsibility, those who are dealing with cultural sciences is a very broad term, I'll come to that in a moment, are capable of reflexivity. An animal cannot have any, it has to reflex, powers reflex, but it doesn't have the capacity of what we call reflexivity. Suppose a book is written for dogs, they can't read it, they can't understand it. But even the most primitive tribe may have an understanding of their life, and then one of you do a report, they can say, "Tell me wrong." They can reflect, they can question, they can interrogate. That capacity is a capacity which is peculiar to human beings, you and me. And therefore, the study of social science is much more difficult. If you are not making such great progress as a physicist who study only matter, as a zoologist who study animals, it's not because you are less intelligent. You are equally intelligent. The problem is your subject matter is much more complex. So you deal with a three-dimensional matter. That is matter, there is life, and there is culture. But what is culture? We all use this term so frequently, probably we lose the meaning of that. Again, long back in 1952, when the American Academy of Social Sciences have asked two anthropologists to find out where one of these cultures is defined, if I remember correctly, they have identified 250 people in the universe. Do we have 9 people in the universe? No. So I do not bother with those. The crux of culture is the ability to create symbols. Symbol. S-Y-M-B-O-L. And what is a symbol? A symbol is something created by human beings, but its meaning cannot be understood through sense organs. You know the sense organs? Eyes. By listening, you won't understand it. By smelling it, you won't understand it. By tasting it, you won't understand it. So the subject matter that you are studying is deeply embedded in culture. And culture means, in the final analysis, creating symbols. And symbols cannot be understood by the brightest of the physicists, the most capable botanists. It has to be deciphered by human beings. Let's give it this example. One of them. It's a good one. I can do it. This is H2O. You said to the laboratory here. That fellow says, sir, this is H2O. This is H2O. Now, think of Gangadhar. I think most of you are Hindus by birth. No accident. I mean, no deliberate act, but an accident. And if you are a beginning Hindu, you believe that water from river Ganga is sacred. And you sense the water from river Ganga, to the laboratory. That fellow also said, sir, this is H2O. Ganga is H2O. Or any sacred object from any religious community. Send it to the laboratory. It is the same as ordinary water. You may say that, look, you are only talking about religion. How about the so-called secular world? So I'll give you another example. You know some who you have seen and you hold in great respect what is called a tricolor or a national flag. What is a national flag? It is three pieces of cloth taken from three different colored stocks, stitched together, and in Ashoka emblem is embossed on that. You know this? If you send your textile technologies, the three pieces of clothes, you will say this is different colors, but the quality scientists seem to be saying, there is no difference between the approach that was used for the national flag and the stock from which you have taken it. This is a statement from some stock. But the moment it becomes a national flag, it is hoisted, you have to salute it. And if you don't respect it, you know what will follow. What is the difference between the ordinary cloth and the cloth you have used to throw the national flag? Materially speaking, it's wonderful. But symbolically, there is another difference. Now, I am trying to invite you to think about, if you want to understand Gangadhar on the one hand and the national flag on the other, how do you understand? Through a textile technologist or a man who is working in the laboratory, the chemistry man, who won't understand. But you can understand it, because you are people who are dealing in social sciences. And it is a three-dimensional matter, life, and symbols. So, first of all, we have to understand social sciences deal with the most complex of things, human beings and society. And that is why you are so precious, your subject is so difficult. And therefore, you don't make very easy progress. Now, generally speaking, there are some areas in social sciences which have made considerable advancement. Economics, for example. But economists make a very simplistic assumption. They don't deal with human beings as a whole. They deal with homo economicus. Only the economic human being, man or woman, who is supposedly behaving based on rationality. How many of you have studied economics? Nobody? And you will be told by your teacher, oh, you might have read in the textbook, there is a thing called supply and demand. The consumer's demand. For example. But apply the theory or that understanding, you want to buy some medicine. And somebody who is very closely related to mother, father, brother, whatever, is in a critical condition. You won't go to the chemist and argue with him about the price. It's not like buying orange outside. Why don't bargain? You want to argue with him, the chemist? Because you want to save the life of somebody who is dear to you. The notion of supply and demand, the theory of consumer's demand, will not simply work there, it will fail. So, when you try to make your subject matter simplistic, not simple, simplistic, you take out only the rationality of the human being. You consider him or her as an economic being, then it's very easy to say. You can make great leaps. And that's why there are all kinds of formula, theorems. And we are all struggling with those theorems. And I am not a psychologist, I am also studying economics as well. So I will be speaking like this here. So, if we are not making our objective study, the subject is simplistic, but look at the human being in his or her totality, then we understand is the most complex object. And this brings me, what I started with, that is, can we think in terms of objectivity? Think of some of the standing features, considerations about science, as if I was writing a novel or a short story. A science is that field of activity where you are expected to be objective. And in physics or physiology, it can be objective in the sense which normally objectivity is understood, but it's not possible in social science. Or that kind of objectivity is not possible. Because how do you understand something as truth through the process of verification? Verification, you know, you verify things. You are looking for proof. I have earlier referred to water, Gangadhar. I remember when I was a student, I read a textbook written by the positivist. I think Lindbergh was the author. He said, if you want to understand the difference, keep a bucket of cold water, warm water, and another bucket of cold water into your hand. You can see in one bucket is cold water, in the other bucket it is warm water, hot water. In this chair, let's take another experiment. Keep in one bucket Ganga Jal and in another bucket the water of your well or tap. Put your hand. There is one difference. How do you really understand the difference between Ganga Jal and ordinary water? Only through symbols. Not through this kind of experimentation. So, generally speaking, the material sciences, and to a large extent even the life sciences, have generalizations which are universal. The objectivity of a generalizing tenor. But when we think of social sciences, where the crux of our study is symbols, we may have to be cautious. Many people will say that abandoning objectivity is not possible in social sciences. I do not agree with that. But it is possible to think in terms of